everybody. This is Lenny Matthews of the LMS Extra Show, produced for by Mr. Alado Calzada. And I got a very, very special guest. We're going down memory lane today, my friend. What is the name?
Stan Tuman.
Stan Tuman. Well, take me down Murray. Talk about Murray. He's going to talk about everybody. You're going to get it right here. The real deal, the real scoop. Right here on the LMS Show. And take it out.
Oh, yes sirree, ready to go.
Welcome to the LMS Show. We're from Pablo's, Newkirk Plaza, Brooklyn, New York. Brooklyn's famous for a lot of Evis Field, Dodgers.
New York Yankees. New York Giants.
Yes, New York Giants. But New York is also famous for a well-known personality. The man who helped get rock and roll going. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the great Alan Freed and Murray Decay later on. And here is the gentleman who's a historian who's been with these gentlemen. What is your name, my friend?
Stan Tuman.
Give up for Stan Tuman, everybody. Oh my goodness.
I'll tell you. It's great to work with these two guys in different eras.
Okay, what era did you work with Alan Freed?
I started with Alan back in 1957, 8 and 9.
Okay.
At Channel 5 in New York.
Okay.
At that time, I was like a screener. That means seeing movies before they put on the air, like for quality commercials and everything like that.
Yes.
While I was there, I met the director of the Alan Freed Show, Amanda Norell. We became very good friends, and he told me to help him out. So for Saturdays, Alan Freed had a dance party there that he invited a lot of groups from various parts of Brooklyn, New York, all over the place to appear on his show, to dance, something like a Dick Clark thing.
Yes.
And it got very popular.
Okay.
Every once in a while, they used to have stars on to sing with their records, lip singing.
Yeah, okay, they lip singing, they sing a lot. They never sang a lot, right?
No.
Okay.
Well, one party there was Laverne Baker.
Oh, I Cry a Tear.
I Cry a Tear.
Tweedy-dee-dee, right?
Yeah, that's right, tweedy-dee, tweedy-dum. And then some other people.
Yes.
But it became very big in Manhattan.
Okay.
And Dick Clark had a show out in Philadelphia.
Right.
So since these two programs became very popular, Alan Freed dancers used to go to Philadelphia for about a week.
Okay.
And the dancers on the Dick Clark show would come into Manhattan for a week. We'd change. No, you know, we were in competition, but it was two big TV shows.
Right.
And
Dick Clark took the show, American Bandstand, national on about August the 4th or the 5th of 1957, right?
Yes.
Because it was a local show, it was just called Bandstand.
Yeah, it was WFYL in Philly.
Philadelphia, right.
And then Channel 7 put his show on network.
Right.
And then he, you know, started the ball rolling there.
Okay.
Because he had a meeting with Freed in Manhattan someplace.
All right.
So I just shook his hands and that was it at that particular time. Because I was more interested with the Alan Freed, you know, situation and everything.
Yes.
He was top man in those days.
Yes.
Of course, he started the name Rock and Roll back in Cleveland.
He started all this in Cleveland, right?
Yes, 1954.
He had groups that, like, your mama wouldn't want you to listen to on the radio, right?
Right,
see
right.
In person, right?
Right.
What were some of these groups that your mama couldn't allow you to listen to on the radio and see in person?
The Cleftones over the air.
Okay.
The Heart Tones, or something like that. You know, that's you see, these people in those particular days were more used to the big band era from the 1940s.
Right.
And the kids, I mean, they went along with their parents, but they wanted music on their own. So they started listening to a guy in Cleveland. And this guy was named Alan Freed. He was a sportscaster first. And they couldn't get a disc jockey because he was drunk at that particular station. And they needed someone to fill in for his place. So they asked Fried to do them a favor and be a disc jockey for a while. The next day, the manager and the sponsor of the station got tons and tons of telephone calls from different people that listened to the show that night. They loved it. So he became a big top name in Cleveland. Now, the manager of WYNS in New York, 1954, called Fried up and they wanted him to be in Manhattan because they know how great he was out in Cleveland. When he had his show on WYNS in Manhattan, he drew bigger crowds. So, in other words, the crowd was so big that they wanted a movie theater to have his shows. A lot of people in those days were harmonizing on the street corners, you know, all over the place.
Yeah, maybe right around here, maybe right around here. Yeah. You know, they had, you know, they, as Kenny Vance said, looking for that echo, right?
Yeah, oh, yes, yes.
Looking forward.
Well, my idols in those times, of course, was Jackie Wilson.
Which one? Is this a picture of him right here?
Right here.
Oh, Jackie, Mr. Excitement himself.
That's right. Lonely Teardrops.
Go ahead, tell me.
When he had the Lonely Teardrops, when he sung at the Brooklyn Fox, or even at Alan Freed shows, he brought down the house.
He brought it down.
Just like Brown.
James Brown. Yes.
He went down on the stage in a certain part of the Lonely Teardrops.
Yes.
And as he was coming up, he had that slow motion, like, you know.
Okay.
And he brought down the theater, they went wild. Because after every performance, he had a man helping him wipe the sweat off his face. He gave everything he had into that show. And, you know, they did 5 or 6 shows a day there, you know, and to do the same number all the time, it's kind of, you know. But he really brought down the house.
Okay, look at this. Alan Freed, Golden Wizards, picks. Long, tall Sally, Little Richard. You ever see Little Richard in person?
Oh, yes.
How was Little Richard? Tell me about Little Richard.
Little Richard, he played the piano, but he went wild.
How wild did he go?
Oh, he used to do all kind of tricks. He almost did like a Jerry Lee Lewis type of thing, you know, get up on the piano and start, you know. He really brought down the house. He had such stars that one was better than the other one. But... Okay,
just another group here. No. Jimmy McCracken.
Do the walk.
Tell me about him.
Well, I just know him for bringing him on stage, you know.
Okay.
Not privately.
Privately, but I mean, he's
just by the music itself. And,
How about He's Gone? The Chantel.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, how'd you like the
Arlene
Chantel?
Arlene Smith.
How'd you like them?
Oh, they were beautiful.
I mean, Arlene Smith had that voice. It's like an operetta type of a voice.
Yes.
Oh my goodness.
And there we go with it. He's Gone. I mean, they're still singing it today.
Yes.
Because, you know, like different people. Of course, it's not the original.
You know, this one I like. This one here, Stranded in the Jungle by the Cadets.
I remember they did those animal sounds.
Baby.
I'm telling you, they did a lot then, you know. Well, the Willows were terrific. When they had a little dance too with the Church Bells My Ring. But they all had their different styles, the way of doing things, the singing on stage, their dancing on stage. But it was terrific, because in that era, everybody was good.
Did you ever met, I met his son, and I met the author of the book, was Little Willie John. Did you ever meet him?
No, I didn't have the pleasure of doing it. Him.
What was your role in getting the acts for the show?
Well, I used to be backstage. And I used to be on the floor where the dressing rooms were. And I had to bring these stars down. See, if one act was on stage, you know, singing or dancing, you know, doing their act.
Okay.
I would get the other acts ready to go downstairs.
Prepped.
Both of these guys wanted the next act to be down by the stage. So when that one particular act was over, the other people that would be on stage would have their act come on. like the Shirelles will wait until Little Richard would get off the stage and then the Shirelles come on. When they're being introduced, they got to be there at that particular moment. Even the band, because when I did three shows at the New York Paramount,
okay,
there was a trumpeter from the band, from the orchestra, that didn't come down early. Everybody was down by the stage. The band was all there, and there was one guy missing. So Alan Freed was mad. So he told me to go up there to the third floor where the band was, the band room was, and get that guy down there. So I had to use the elevator from the theater to go upstairs to the band room and get this guy down. And he was furious because he wants everybody to be there on time.
Well, I don't blame him on that. I want people there on time when I do shows too.
Yeah, anybody that appeared in Alan Freed shows knows that he was really stringent on time.
He was rough,
but it paid off. It paid off greatly. Because that's what made him famous, and you know, all their records were being played on the radio.
How did he treat the artists? You know,
he treated them good.
Okay, and what way he treated them good?
He let them have freedom, whatever, you know, even the show was over. You know, they wanted to go someplace, you know, they had him go. But you had to be there at showtime.
He wanted you there at showtime, period.
Yes. Oh, yes. I remember when I was trying to get tickets at the time to when I was doing the screen work at Channel 5, I used to go over to Junior's downtown Brooklyn.
Okay, Junior's, everybody.
And Alan Freed used to hang out there, you know, with some other members that he knows. I used to say, Alan, could you get me backstage? You know, and he knew me because I worked in Channel 5 also. He says, okay, Stan, sign a piece of paper, go to the stage door and give it to the guy that was there, and I got backstage. No trouble at all.
He treated, what I heard about, he did treat the artists right, nice, right?
Yes.
Because I remember they had a show at the Madison Square Garden, and you were at the theater, Madison Square Garden, and they were talking about some people who remember working with him.
Oh, yes. Harvey and the Moon Glows.
Harvey and the Moon Glows. Did you have a chance to meet with them?
Oh, yes. He managed them also for 3 years. He was their manager. You know, of course, they made Sincerely because Alan Freed wrote that song.
Oh, yeah.
Sincerely.
I remember there was a lot of, I'm glad you mentioned about that because many of these records back then, like say the Harvey and Moon Glows make records Sincerely.
Yep.
Sometimes they had back in the day where they had cover versions of these records.
Yeah.
Like the McGuire sisters were number one.
Yeah, I remember that, yeah. Yeah, I mean, they copied a lot of this. I mean, that's what in there. I have an album of the McGuire sisters too. And they also had that song Sincerely in there. But on the cover, it says a song written by Alan Freed.
Okay.
They gave him the credit. So every time when you hear some silly, you know, Alan Freed did it. And they were terrific.
And I would have a grilled cheese sandwich.
Grilled cheese?
Yes.
A rocking grilled cheese.
Rocking grilled cheese.